October 25th, 2022 saw the passing of Jules Bass, who, along with his partner, author Rankin Jr., was the founder of Rankin-Bass Productions. Even if you've never heard of the company, chances are you're familiar with their work, especially their iconic holiday specials. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, Frosty the Snowman, The Little Drummer Boy, Santa Claus is Coming to Town, among many others, all of which, interestingly enough, remain internally consistent with one another. Yes, decades before the MCU, Rankin-Bass Productions had its own cinematic universe, and if you're interested in falling down that rabbit hole, I recommend this video essay by Quentin Reviews. Aside from their holiday specials, Rankin-Bass Productions was, surprisingly enough, involved with many other animated projects. For example, did you know they partnered with the Japanese animation company TopCraft to create an animated TV series? You might have heard of it. Yes, the same company that created Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer was also responsible for the ThunderCats. Don't worry, that's not just a random fact, it's gonna come up later. Promise. Rankin-Bass Productions also teamed up with TopCraft to create several animated fantasy movies. Some of their most notable included the 1977 animated adaptation of The Hobbit, the 1982 adaptation of The Last Unicorn, and the 1982 animated film The Flight of Dragons. Anyone else here know about that movie? Just me? Okay. Anyway, if you really want to have your mind blown, after it went bankrupt and dissolved in 1985, TopCraft and its assets would eventually be acquired by a certain animation director, who would turn it into another animation studio. You might have heard of the guy. His name was Hayao Miyazaki, and he created Studio Ghibli. Yeah, you probably never imagined that Rudolph, ThunderCats, and Totoro were all connected, did ya? So here we have Rankin-Bass Productions, a company famous for both its stop-motion animated specials and its animated high-fantasy films, created in collaboration with TopCraft. But what would happen if you combined the best of both worlds, stop-motion with high-fantasy? Well, you would get the holiday special I'll be reviewing, directed by Jules Bass himself, and created as the final Rankin-Bass holiday animated film. This is the 1985 special, The Life and Adventures of Santa Claus. The special is based on the children's book of the same name, written in 1902 by L. Frank Baum. Yes, the same person who wrote The Wizard of Oz. Interestingly enough, the book is even canon to the Oz mythos. In the fifth Oz book, The Road to Oz, Santa Claus appears as one of the many guests for Princess Ozma's birthday party, among many other cameos of other characters from Baum's other books. Of course, if you want to go down that rabbit hole, I suggest watching the Oz book review series by The Hungry Reader, along with his supplementary, The Bomb videos. Of course, I would also be remiss to mention that this is not the only animated adaptation of The Life and Adventures of Santa Claus. There was also a direct-to-video animated movie released in 2000. It was alright. I remember catching it on Cartoon Network, and I thought it was alright. Personally, I prefer the Rankin-Bass version, which is why I'm reviewing that. This story begins in the Enchanted Forest of Burzee, an age ago. There, the Great Ak, the Master Woodsman of the world, meets up with Queen Zerline, the Queen of the Wood Nymphs. Both of them are preparing to congregate with the other immortal spirits for a very important meeting. The other immortals make their grand entrance with a royal procession, and what follows is perhaps the special's finest musical number.
Bid you welcome.
In my opinion, this music number is the number one reason to watch the special. It is such a grand and epic orchestration. It sounds like something you could hear in the live-action Lord of the Rings films.
The master of the sound imps.
Speak Speaking of Lord of the Rings, the music for this special was composed by Bernard Hoffer, who composed music for other Rankin-Bass productions like ThunderCats and the 1980 animated adaptation of Return of the King. Yes, aside from The Hobbit, Rankin-Bass also created an animated movie based on The Lord of the Rings, albeit the very last book, for reasons that completely elude me. If you want to know more about that movie, I'd recommend watching the review of the animated Tolkien films by David Gansel. Man, I'm recommending a lot of videos in this review. Anyway, if there's one good thing about the animated version of the very last book in the Rings trilogy, it's the musical numbers, which also have no right being as majestically epic as they are.
Bilbo found that shiny ring in Gollum's cave of gloom. He never thought that it would turn into a ring of doom.
The bearer of the ring, the wearer of the ring, stands on the very brink of fate. Staring into eyes of darkness and despair that rise and shrink with hate.
Less can be more, and small can be beautiful. I don't want it all. Just part of wonderful, for roads go ever, ever on. To the lands beyond the sea. On a white ship will I sail. Watching shadows part for me.
And yes, that also includes the infamous song with singing orcs, Where There's a Whip, There's a Way.
Where there's a whip, there's a way. Where there's a whip, there's a way. Where there's a whip,
we don't want to go to war today. But the Lord of the Lashes has said, nay, nay. We're gonna march all day, all day, all day.
I don't care what other people say, that song's a real banger. Anyway, where was I? Oh yeah, after that epic musical number, the Council of Elrond convenes, excuse me, the Council of the Immortals, and the Great Act pleads his case for Santa Claus by telling him his backstory. Nearly 60 years earlier, the Great Act discovered a human baby on the edge of the forest. After much consideration, he decides to allow the baby, who is named Claus, to be raised in the forest by Nisil the Wind Nymph and Shiegra the Lioness. An important mythical figure raised and nursed by a wild animal? Insert obvious reference to other mythical figure nursed and raised by a wild animal here. And so, the young Claus grows up and spends his childhood days carefree in the enchanted forest. Through a musical montage, of course.
Till his careless days are over, we'll be wrapped in
while the other immortal denizens of the forest do not age, the young Claus, as a human being, does, and once he reaches adulthood, the other immortal spirits bid him farewell as he prepares to venture into the human world where he belongs. But before he does, the Great Act treats him to a magical journey around the world, where he shows the sheltered Claus the trials and tribulations his fellow human beings experience. They visit Europe, where medieval peasants toil away in the fields for mere scraps while their feudal lords feast upon the fruit of their labor.
Squire Rushwell tells me the serfs are acting up again.
He only took it because he was hungry. It's fine for you. You've got everything you need. Surely we can do something.
Soon they'll start dreaming of another kind of life. And that would be the end of all this. We can't afford that now, can we? Sooner or later, they'd want what we have.
They visit Japan, where young samurai are trained to fight, sometimes to the death, on behalf of their own feudal lords. They visit Arabia, where poor orphan children are forced to beg for food and money. And then they return to Europe once more, where Claus learns about the concept of war. Having witnessed humanity's inhumanity to their fellow man, Claus ponders why people endure such hard lives.
What is man's use? Why is he here? Why is he born at all?
To leave the world in some way better than he found it.
Great act. How can I do that?
You must follow your star, as others have before you, and try to bring a measure of love and joy to the world.
And so, having determined to take the Great Axe's words to heart, Claus departs from the Forest of Burzee and ventures into the world of man, determined to do his best to do his part to make the world better. His travels take him to the Valley of Ho-Ha-Ho, so named because, well...
Ho-Ha-Ho.
There, the other immortal spirits surprise him by building him a new home and treating him to a homewarming party. And so, Claus spends his days attending to the children in a nearby village. One evening, an orphaned boy appears frozen on his doorstep. Claus takes the little boy inside for the evening, and the next morning, treats him to a toy cat he had been whittling away at. The boy shows his gift to the other children, and then they all start begging Claus to make them their own toys.
We wanna wake up to a big surprise!
Big surprise!
A wooden cat with yellow green eyes!
Yellow green eyes!
A little black cat with no meow!
A funny little cat, please tell us how!
A silly little cat with a tongue that's red!
A pretty little toy we could take to bed!
And so Claus determines to make it his life's mission to give children a little joy in their lives by making and delivering toys for them. Unfortunately, his efforts to deliver the toys are initially thwarted by the Aquas, evil creatures who thrive upon the misery of children and influence them to do bad things. A few other failed delivery attempts soon force the Great Axe to intervene and implore the evil creatures to stop interfering with Claus's deliveries. King Ogre defies Great Axe, and the two factions go to war with one another. And so the Great Axe and the Forest of Burzee go to battle against King Ogre and his minions in what is essentially this special's Siege of Gondor. You know, some people might criticize this action scene as being anticlimactic, but personally, I love how the evil Aguas are charging into battle with their intention to use brute force, only to be thwarted by the other creatures through magical tricks. It just makes for delightful schadenfreude. And so the Aguas are defeated, and Santa Claus is free to make his toy deliveries. He is aided by one of the other magical creatures, Peter Nook, who provides him with 8 reindeer. Because Santa Claus. Unfortunately, they arrive to the village too late and discover all the houses had been locked for the evening. Fortunately, Claus decides to deliver the presents by sliding down the chimneys and leaving the toys inside the children's stockings hanging from the fireplace. Because Santa Claus. When he returns, Claus asks Peter Nook if he can use his reindeer again to make another delivery. Nook agrees, but only for one night a year. They decide to make that one night Christmas Eve so the children can have the toys as presents on Christmas morning. Because Santa Claus. More than 60 years pass, and Santa Claus is off making his yearly deliveries. It's here where the Great Axe ends his story, and he informs the other immortals that Claus will pass away later that evening. He implores them to allow Santa to continue living by bestowing upon him the mantle of immortality. Of course, the other immortals agree, Santa Claus is given the mantle and made immortal, and he lives on to continue delivering Christmas presents to the children of the world. By the way, remember when I mentioned how Rankin-Bass helped create the ThunderCats? Well, as I said, that wasn't just a random factoid. Many of the characters in this special were performed by voice actors who also worked for that cartoon. For example, Queen Zerline was performed by Lynn Lipton, who also voiced Chitara. Tingler was performed by Bob McFadden, who also voiced Snarf. Peter Nook was performed by Peter Newman, who also voiced Tigra. The Commander of the Wind Demons was performed by Larry Kenny, who also voiced Lion-O. King Ogwa was performed by Earl Hyman, who also voiced Panthro. And Santa Claus was voiced by Earl Hammond, who also voiced Mumra. As I mentioned before, this was the very last animated holiday special created by Rankin-Bass Productions. The special aired on CBS on December 17th, 1985. Unfortunately, it didn't do that well. As Wikipedia explains, it only managed to earn a 12.5 rating and a 19% audience share, ranking it third in its time slot and placing it in the bottom 10 for the week. And so, the Rankin-Bass holiday specials ended, not with a bang, but a whimper. A pretty well-made whimper, but a whimper nonetheless. There is a reason why this special is one of the more lesser-known of Rankin-Bass's filmography. As for Rankin-Bass itself, the company would officially shut down nearly 15 years later, on December 18, 2000. Arthur Rankin Jr. would pass away on January 30, 2014, and his partner, Jules Bass, as mentioned earlier, passed away last year. The Rankin-Bass library is currently owned by Warner Brothers Entertainment, and many of the holiday specials have aired for more than 20 years on the Family Channel, now Freeform, during its 25 Days of Christmas seasonal event. Since 2018, many of these specials, including this one, air on AMC in December during its Best Christmas Ever seasonal event. As of this recording, this special is available to stream on AMC+.
Psst! Of course, television recordings of this special have also been uploaded to Daily Motion and the Internet Archive, which is where I got my video footage. But don't tell anyone!
In 2022, Warner Brothers partnered with NBC Universal to release the complete Rankin-Bass Christmas Collection, a 9-disc DVD box set which includes 18 specials from Rudolph to, well, this one. If you're interested in Rankin-Bass, it's available to purchase on Amazon. Seriously, go buy physical media while we still can, until our corporate overlords decide to eliminate it altogether and force us to pay exuberant fees to stream everything. And considering how said corporate overlords have been acting recently, well, hey Zaslav, don't you think about it. The Life and Adventures of Santa Claus is a forgotten relic among the Rankin-Bass holiday specials, but it certainly is an underrated gem. It truly combines the best of Rankin-Bass's output between its iconic stop-motion animated holiday specials and its beautiful animated fantasy movies. If you love Rudolph and Frosty, and you love The Last Unicorn and The Hobbit, I highly recommend you watch the special this holiday season. It was a good final bow for Rankin-Bass and its legacy. And with that, this is the very last review of 2023. I'll be taking a short holiday break and resuming video production by next year. Until then, feel free to like, share, and subscribe, follow me on social media, and feel free to buy one of my books on Amazon. They make great stocking stuffers, so be sure to get your loved ones the gift of reading this Christmas. Anyway, Black Lives Matter, trans rights are human rights, Jesus Christ is Lord, happy holidays! Merry Christmas, and have a Happy New Year.